Many of you, I'm sure, have noticed over the past few years the media pushing for veganism and a lowering of overall meat consumption, especially now that climate change hysteria is through the roof. Many celebrities such as the Williams sisters, Novak Djokovic, and even the Terminator himself and unusual associate of Warren Buffett and Jacob Rothschilds is vegan, or at the very least pretending to be vegan in order to push the agenda. But it doesn't stop there. Monopoly men including Jeff Bezos, who has been known to eat iguana for dinner, is heavily invested in the vegan movement, along with vaccine man Bill Gates and Richard Branson. And yet all we hear from the vegans is how the meat industry is propagandizing us into eating meat. But veganism isn't an entirely new phenomenon. In fact, it's been part of the global plan for humanity for at least 100 years. One most notable account is from Lord Birkenhead, a Freemason who was Lord High Chancellor under Winston Churchill's government. Writing an article in the Cosmopolitan in 1929 under the title Save This for Your Children's Children, he not only spoke about babies being grown in laboratories and how a mother's love is simply chemical, but he also spoke about how meat in future would be genetically engineered to never stop growing, so you could simply cut off a slice only for it to regrow and continually be sold. Lab-grown meat is already a reality, as predicted by the Lord of Birkenhead. Meat which will have little to no nutrients, and any it will have will no doubt be synthetic, similar to today's supplements which are toxic and over a long period of time are detrimental to human health, a topic I'll perhaps get into in a later video. We're already being bombarded with these fake vegan meats and fake vegan cheeses. Things like the Beyond Burger and the Impossible Burger are being given a ludicrous amount of news coverage. You need meat to live and be healthy. It's something every ancient culture understood. That's why there's never in history been a single case of a vegan tribe or civilization, or even just people who ate less than 40% meat and animal produce. It's actually unsustainable to rely on a diet mostly consisting of plants. If you're thinking about going vegan, just consider whether or not it's something you really want to waste your time and money and your good health doing.
Guys, it's Natasha Campbell on the right again.
I'm going to talk about a very hot topic, a very important topic, vegetarianism and veganism. You're probably all aware of the fact that there is a movement around the world for this lifestyle, for a plant-based lifestyle. For the first time in centuries, all the major capital cities in Europe and in America now have vegetarian and vegan cafes and restaurants, and there are demonstrations for this lifestyle, and there is a huge amount of misinformation going around about this lifestyle. And of course, that reflects in what kind of patients I see in my clinic, and many other doctors and many other practitioners see in their clinic. I see youngsters, young girls and boys with anorexia nervosa, with bipolar disorder, with depression, with schizophrenia, with rheumatoid arthritis, with chronic fatigue, with fibromyalgia, developed because of misguided vegetarianism. Majority of these kids were perfectly healthy children before they decided to become vegetarians. And because of all this propaganda in the world, and because our mainstream authorities are silent on this subject, and not only silent, but many dietetic associations actually supported and promoted as a healthy lifestyle around the world, many parents in our world believe that if their child decided to become a vegetarian, they must support it. It is possible to be a healthy vegetarian, but you have to know what you're doing, because it's very easy to get into trouble, to run out of nutrients, and to undermine your most fundamental metabolic balances in the body. and to get into trouble. And of course, these youngsters don't do any study. They just cut out meat because they've heard something, or some friend decided to do that, or they've seen a film about how industrial agriculture treats animals, which is appalling. It's very, very cruel. And in many cases, that's what puts them off eating meat. Stopping to eat meat is not the right thing to do. It's not the right way to fight that system. But that's what these youngsters are compelled to do. And they start living, of course, on pasta and cheese, and biscuits and cakes, and breakfast cereals, processed carbohydrates. And what's the next thing happens? Processed carbohydrates are the cause of our obesity epidemic. The breakfast cereals, the bread, the sandwiches, the pasta, the sugar, the cakes, the biscuits. That's what causes obesity epidemic, because it causes too much insulin in the blood, and insulin is a master fat storage hormone. If you've got too much insulin in your blood, you'll be storing everything as fat. A piece of lettuce in your body will be stored as fat, straight into your thighs. A little salad, a cucumber will be stored as fat in your body, as long as you have high levels of insulin. How do these youngsters finish up with high levels of insulin? Because they're eating wheat, sugar all day long. These things are pre-digested for us in our big factories by the food industry. They require virtually no digestion. They absorb as a glucose, all carbohydrates absorb as molecules of glucose and other monosugars, and they dump a huge amount of glucose into the bloodstream. A syrup, a huge injection of syrup after a breakfast cereal goes into your bloodstream. Blood sugar level is kept within very tight limits by the human body because too high, too low can kill. So the body has very strict mechanisms for dealing with any excesses, too high, too low. When it's too high like that, the body is put into a shock state and it gives the pancreas a command to produce uncontrolled amounts of insulin to get rid of that sugar out of the bloodstream as soon as possible, because sugar cannot leave your blood on its own. It has to be escorted by insulin. It is insulin that takes the sugar's hand, says, now, Jay, come with me. Opens the doors on the cells in the muscles, in the brain, and all the other tissues in the body. Opens those little doors on the cells and pushes the sugar in. And then the cell can use that sugar for producing energy, for manufacturing various molecules, various things, and for various other functions. But if the person is dumping huge amounts of glucose into their bloodstream for breakfast, lunch, and dinner, and in between all the time, the person finishes up with too much insulin in their bloodstream all the time, dealing with that situation. Insulin is a master fat storage hormone. It will store everything as fat as long as you support too much of this substance in your blood. So these youngsters start putting weight on. And for them, that's all the alarm bells go off. We have another misguidance in our world, that eating fat makes you fat. A simplistic idea that our dietetic association promotes and another mainstream promotes. So what's the next thing this youngster would do if she started putting weight on? She cuts out all fat from her body. Our immune system cannot live without fat. A week or 2 weeks, her immune system collapses, she gets infectious mononucleosis, cold, antibiotic. She was a healthy child before she started. All these courses of antibiotics destroy her gut flora, and she becomes a gapster. She develops gaps. And the next thing is mental illness. And the next thing is suicidal attempts, sectioning in the psychiatric hospitals, psychiatric medication, the whole slippery slope. Her life is finished. She will have no life from that day on. This beautiful young girl. And the parents are desperate to help, but it's too late. They should have helped when she was 13 and she came home and announced that I'm going to become a vegetarian. And they said, oh, what wonderful idea. That's what majority of parents do nowadays. So we have a huge confusion about vegetarianism in the world. Some choose this lifestyle after discovering how industrial agriculture treats animals and birds, which is appalling. Some believe that this is the healthiest lifestyle. They really believe that vegetarianism is healthy and veganism is healthy. Some do it for emotional, religious, or political reasons. some believe that they are saving the planet. There's a huge amount of propaganda online and in many books saying that by becoming a vegan and vegetarian, you're saving the planet. That this is kind to animals. Nutritional science adds a lot to the confusion by all their propaganda going out that red meat is bad for you, stop eating red meat, stop eating fat, stop eating eggs, you know, and eat all those fruit and vegetables 5 a day, as Zoe explained, or 10 a day, or 8 a day, or whatever else a day. The population generally are given an idea that healthy lifestyle is eating fruit and vegetables. You can't eat meat, you can't eat fat, you can't eat eggs, you can't eat fish. You can't eat dairy. You just have to eat lots of fruit and vegetables, lots of fruit and vegetables. That's the healthy lifestyle. That's the idea in the mainstream. That's what people believe. Doctors see more and more young people damaging their health and destroying their lives through veganism and vegetarianism, misguided vegetarianism. So, should we all become vegetarian or vegan? If we're saving the planet, if this is kind to animals, and if this is a healthy lifestyle, and so on. So let's talk about it in more detail. What I found that there is no clarity, and there is no science on the subject. There are a few scientific studies which were done, obviously, by vegans and vegetarians, which are very promotional, and there are, you know, so many holes in these studies that they're like a sieve. They really cannot be trusted, these studies. There is no serious science going on vegetarianism and veganism. A few studies coming in now to show that vegans have more mental illness, that veganism quite often leads to developing cancer. What I see in my clinic, that children of vegetarians have blood disorders very often, have delayed puberty, delayed sexual development, transsexual development, inappropriate sexual development very often, anemia is very common, and muscle disorders and neurological disorders, very common in children of vegetarian parents. And autism is rampant in there. It doesn't protect for autism at all. I have many vegetarian families whose children are autistic. So how does it all work? So let's look at the most fundamental aspects of how nature has designed this planet and all our life on this planet. All energy on our beautiful planet is recycled. Nothing goes to waste, nothing gets subtracted. Everything eats everything. When we die, microbes will eat us, we will turn into soil. From that soil, the plants will grow. You know, there is one particular interesting occasion that was demonstrated very well, that in a cemetery, an apple tree was planted above a couple of people. And then many, many, many years later, something happened there, they were excavated or whatever. The roots of the plant tree were the shape of those bodies. The tree ate the people. If you want your apple tree to grow well, put a dead animal in front of it. Because trees eat meat. If any of you have chickens, you would know that their most favorite food is meat. You give them some mince out of a packet, they will drop everything else, and they'll just eat that. Their favorite food is meat. So the plants will eat us, whatever dead creatures fall on the ground, the plants will eat. And then herbivorous animals eat plants, and then we eat those animals, and the whole circle continues. Everything on this planet eats everything. All energy is recycled in all shapes and forms. The new energy comes to the planet all the time from our beautiful sun. Sunlight. That is a form of energy that comes onto the planet. In order to capture that energy and convert it into solid matter, Mother Nature created plants. They have photosynthesis. They capture the sunlight, and through photosynthesis, they convert it into green matter, into green mass. Something we can touch and eat and ferment, something that becomes food on the planet. In order to then consume the energy of the sun in the form of plants, Mother Nature created herbivorous animals. They eat plant matter. In order for them to digest that plant matter, Mother Nature equipped them with a very special digestive system, which is called rumen. A cow has four stomachs, which is rumen. It is huge, it takes a huge part of her digestive system. And the rumen is full of microbes. That is where the bulk of her gut flora is sitting, in the rumen. She has bacteria in there, viruses, fungi, protozoa, worms, flukes, all sorts of creatures in her stomach. They are the ones that break the grass for the cow. It's not the cow that digests the grass that she eats. It's her rumen and her microbial community in the rumen that breaks it down for her. In fact, the scientific fact is, no creature on this planet can digest plants, apart from microbes. Microbes are the only creatures on the planet that can really digest plants. They have amazing ways of fermenting carbohydrates, cleaving off proteins, converting them into various forms, turning carbohydrates into short-chain fatty acids. Apparently, about 70% of all the carbohydrate sugars from the grass in the rumen is converted into short-chain fatty acids, which are saturated fat. So the cow actually lives on a very high fat diet. Very, very high, and all of it is saturated. She absorbs it in that form. And the cows chew the cud, don't they? They're chewing all the time. What are they doing? She would swallow a mouthful of grass into her rumen. The microbes there will work on that, digest what they can, extract what they can, and then they will send it back into her mouth. She will regurgitate it. She'll chew it a little bit more, swallow it again. Apparently, a cow chews the same mouthful of grass 200 times. Somebody actually calculated that. Somebody actually counted. And that's a symbiotic relationship, a beautiful symbiotic relationship that is right there in front of us, that nature works on symbiosis, nature works on cooperation. Where microbes are cooperating with this big animal, with a cow, so she can digest the grass that she's eating. And then all those nutrients pass into her intestines where they are absorbed, and then whatever remnants there are go into her bowel and she will excrete it. So the bulk of her gut flora is sitting at the beginning of her digestive system in the rumen. It's an ingenious digestive system. Where plant matter is converted into protein, fat, maybe saturated fat, and sugars by the rumen microbes. Only microbes are able to digest plants well. And these animals chew the cud. Antelopes, deer, goats, sheep. These are all ruminant animals. In order then to consume the energy of the sun in the form of the herbivorous animals, Mother Nature created another group of creatures on the planet, omnivores and predators. And in order for these creatures to be able to digest the mass of the cow, the herbivorous animals, Mother Nature provided them with a very special digestive system, which is very different digestive system. They have a small stomach. If that stomach is healthy, it has virtually no microbes in it because it produces hydrochloric acid and pepsin. And hydrochloric acid and pepsin are only able to break down meat, fish, eggs, and milk. And this is our digestive system. Human digestive system is the same as the digestive system in predators, in dogs, cats, lions, and so on. Mother Nature made that decision for us. That's the kind of digestive system we were given.